The next question comes from kinetics. It says two reactions R1 and R2 have identical pre-exponential factors. That means if you write down the rate equation, K1 is A e raised to minus E1 by RT. K2 is A e raised to minus E2 by RT. You can write down A, the pre-exponential factor is the same. And they also say that activation energy of R1 exceeds that of R2 by 10 kilojoules per mole. What does that mean? That E1, that is activation energy of R1, exceeds R2. This is E2 plus 10 kilojoules per mole. Let's not eat away the units because they are important. If K1 and K2 are rate constants for the reactions R1 and R2 respectively at 300 Kelvin, then ln K2 by K1 is, we just have to divide, take logarithms and calculate. Let's do that. K2 by K1 is e raised to E2 minus E1 by RT. Am I right? EK2, no, this is minus of. It is this. You take ln K2 by K1. And this is simply E1 minus E2 by RT. I'm supposed to find this. That means I'm supposed to substitute E1 minus E2. That is 10 kilojoules per mole. Watch out for the unit. 10 kilojoules per mole. Why am I writing this as joules per mole? Because R is going to be 8.314 joules per mole Kelvin. And temperature is 300 Kelvin. There we are. If you just start calculating this, how much is this going to be? 10 raised to 3 goes 0.3. 8.3 into 0.3, that is 24.9 something. This is 10 divided by 24.942. Come on, yeah, this is 25. 10 by 25, 1 by 2.5, reciprocal of 2.5 is around 0.4. Am I missing out on some factor? Maybe, just check that out. This is not 20, this is 0.3. 0.3 means this is 2.4, yes. 2.49, that is around 2.5. 10 by 2.5 is close to 4. So the correct answer is 4. That's it. Question number 82. Which of the following molecules is least resonance stabilized? 1, 2, 3, 4. If you see, furan is aromatic, yes, because of this lone pair of electrons, 2 to 4 and 2 to 6. If you look at a pyridine definitely is aromatic. Benzene obviously is the aromatic compound. But this compound, if you see, this is sp3 hybrid carbon atom. This carbon cannot become a part of conjugation. This is a non-aromatic system. Due to aromaticity, 1, 2, 4, all of these have beautiful resonance energies. 3 obviously would be significantly down because although there is conjugation, but again, you know, just general conjugation is way poorer as compared to the extraordinary phenomenon of aromaticity. So the poorest is 3. So we have 3 as the answer. The group having isoelectronic species is, now which species are isoelectronic? The species which contains same number of total electrons are isoelectronic. If you observe, these species are reasonably close in periodic table. You have O, you have F, you have Ne, and then if you go on this side, you have Na and Mg. Now this is the location when it comes to periodic table. If you look at the number of electrons, in O, if you add one more electron, you get F. In F, if you add one more electron, you get Ne. Of course, nucleus also changes, but I'm just talking with respect to electronic configurations. That means if I have to match them, taking neon as the, you know, base, F plus one more electron, oxygen plus two more electrons. Now, all of them contain 10 electrons each, but sodium and magnesium contain 11 and 12. So remove 1 and 2 electrons respectively and there you are. All these species are nicely, happily, beautifully isoelectronic. and the flat straightforward answer is, just match this 4. That's it. 84 looks very ugly and dangerous, but if you remember the formula, it's very simple. The radius of second Bohr orbit of hydrogen atom is, now if you actually wish to calculate that radius using this data, I mean this is suicidal. Rather, if you remember the formula, R is R naught n square by z. R naught is the radius of first Bohr orbit of hydrogen atom, which is 0.529 angstrom units. Probably you're aware. In case you are, you would gain. N in this case is 2 and z is 1. So that is 0.529 into 4. Multiply that by 4 and what do you have? You have 3 is the answer. That's it. Straightforward. Now this is a very interesting question. It says the major product obtained in the following reaction is, and you have a ring which contains an ester and a carboxylic acid. Ester and carboxylic acid, alkene of course is inert towards diabyl H. It doesn't undergo reductions. It is treated with diabyl H and you are supposed to offer the products. Now it's one of the better questions in this examination. What happens if you first add diabyl H to a reagent like this? The first activity is that hydride ions from this are going to react with COOH, the acidic COOH. There is going to be liberation of hydrogen. Acha. So that is going to destroy some of diabyl H. Yes. And COOH would get converted to COO minus. Yes, of course. You get COO minus. Great. Now, one of the lesser known facts, although this is a very common reagent, but the mechanism is not often very common. Let me tell you that the reductions which involve diabyl H proceed by electrophilic addition mechanism. They don't go by nucleophilic like Grignard, which means that if C double bond O group is attached to electron releasing groups, they are reduced more easily and more rapidly by diabyl H rather than the electron deficient compounds. So if you have COO minus, please note Grignard reagent is not going to attack carboxylate ion because it goes by nucleophilic addition and this is already electron rich. So nucleophile would not approach this very easily. On the other hand, being electron rich, this is susceptible to reduction by diborane, and similarly it is also very susceptible to reduction by diabyl H also. Diabyl H will very favorably reduce first COO minus group to CHO group. Mechanism being similar to diborane reduction, and you get first this gets converted to COH. Now COH is not equally electron rich. So what happens? What happens is the reduction by diabyl H can be stopped. What do you mean by can be stopped? If you vary temperatures, if you raise temperature, if you wish, you can make the reaction more vigorous, and aldehydes can be reduced under certain conditions of temperature and concentrations. But usually, as per the options which have been offered to us, it is either CHO or unreduced COOH. So, I mean, that means that the paper setter is expecting the reduction to stop at aldehyde. In that case, yes, it does stop at aldehyde in this case. And what about esters? Esters are also electron rich, but not as much as carboxylate ions. If you have limited quantity of diabyl H, first acidic hydrogen would be removed, next carboxylate ion would be reduced, and third ester also is going to get reduced. Ester would be reduced and you have this RCOOR dash. If you add HH here, see this is what it happened. After diabyl H addition, this is what you normally get. And with this reduction, please note this is hemiacetal, so this can break off. And you would get RCOH plus R dash OH. The group which was connected to oxygen becomes alcohol, and the group which was connected to carbon becomes aldehyde. In the same fashion, this also is going to break up, and the product which you're going to obtain is going to be like this. You're going to have OH and you're going to have aldehyde here. What about this? This also changes to nice, happy, beautiful aldehyde. And
There we are. 1 is the answer.
The next also is a really easy question. It's a simple identification of oxidation reduction. Watch this. Which of the following reactions is an example of a redox reaction? Fascinating though these reactions may appear, they are all very straightforward reactions. In this case, please note, there is a dissociation of F minus. It's a Lewis acid based reaction. F minus breaks away from this and gets attached to PTF5. Beautiful reaction, but again, there is no change in oxidation number of any species. Xenon is plus 2, it is plus 2. Fluorine is minus 1, it continues to be minus 1. Phosphorus is plus 5, it continues to be plus 5. Same fashion, if you observe here, there is some misprint here apparently. This was XZF6. It has been typed in our program as XZF2, but this is in J paper, it was actually XZF6. If you hydrolyze XZF6, you get XZOF4. Oxidation number of xenon continues from plus 6 to plus 6. Fluorine from minus 1 to minus 1. Oxygen from minus 2 to minus 2. And hydrogen from plus 1 to plus 1. There is no redox. If you watch out for the third one, again, similar idea. XZO2F2 continues with xenon as plus 6. There is no oxidation reduction of any kind. But the fourth one, if you watch out for this, xenon from plus 4 changes to plus 6. It undergoes oxidation. And oxygen from plus 1 state gets reduced to 0. There is a reduction of oxygen. Is it a redox reaction? Yes, fourth is. And there we are. The next question comes from solid state. Normally questions from solid state are elementary, formula based, but this one beats all the previous questions because this is the most elementary formula based question, and here it is. It says a metal crystallizes in a face centered cubic structure. If the edge length of this unit cell is A, now the edge length of this unit cell is A, then the distance of closest approach between two atoms in metallic crystal will be. Now what is the closest distance between two atoms? If the atoms are touching each other, then obviously the distance between them would be the closest. And what is that distance? By common sense, you can see this distance is going to be 2 times radius. By simple geometry, diagonal is A root 2, which is equal to 4R. Fine. So A is 2 root 2R. So 2R, which is the distance of closest approach, how much is 2R? This is A upon root 2. Oh my God, this is the answer, A by root 2. That's it. This brings us to question number 88. Slightly better question. Watch this. It says, sodium salt of an organic acid X produces effervescence with concentrated sulfuric acid. Fine. So this is the first item. Effervescence with concentrated sulfuric acid. Point to be noted, my lord. X reacts with acidified aqueous CaCl2 to give a white PPT. This is the second idea. With aqueous CaCl2, it gives a white PPT. Fine. And the PPT decolorizes acidic solution of KMnO4, which means now KMnO4 is an oxidizing agent. That means that precipitate must be a reducing agent. And in that PPT, one item is calcium, and calcium ions are not a reducing agent. So naturally, the anion must be a reducing agent. Decolorizes acidified KMnO4. This is third. So what are we looking for? A, something which can produce an effervescence with concentrated sulfuric acid, and this is not something which you may like much. Second property is significantly easier, and third is the easiest of all. Second says it produces a white PPT with slightly acidified calcium chloride, and third says it is a reducing agent. That means it can easily get oxidized. Now, organic acids, you must have studied this in organic chemistry. Organic acids normally do not undergo oxidation very easily. They are not easily oxidizable like aldehydes or alcohols. But exception being, there are two very popular organic acids which are easily and rapidly oxidized, and they are A, formic acid, and B, oxalic acid. If you watch, formate ions and oxalate ions are already enlisted. Acetic acid or benzoic acid, which will give you these salts, Now, are these reducing acids? Matlab, do they undergo oxidation? Sorry. Ultimately, any organic compound, if you burn, you can burn it. It can undergo oxidation. But benzoic or carboxylic or any other carboxylic acid in general is not popularly termed as a reducing agent. They don't go around decolorizing KMnO4. So on the basis of third criteria, you can plainly reject 2 and 4 without any knowledge of qualitative analysis. By simple knowledge of organic chemistry, oxidation, reduction, two options can be discarded. What about 1 and 3 now? Let's see. X reacts with acidified aqueous CaCl2 to give a white PPT. Now, formate ions, the beautiful part is formate and carboxylate, both these salts are nearly always soluble with various cations. You will always find that if formates don't undergo redox, all formates are water soluble, all carbox sorry all acetate ions are also nearly always water soluble, and calcium salt is definitely water soluble. So formate would not give you a white PPD with calcium chloride, but what about oxalates? Yeah, they can. And why do you keep a slightly acidified aqueous calcium chloride? Because otherwise people are afraid that even calcium hydroxide, which is also insoluble, might precipitate. So in order to avoid any precipitation of hydroxide, you slightly acidify that. And if you have oxalate, calcium oxalate can precipitate. And I hope you remember, this is the same compound which, if precipitated in kidneys, produces kidney stone. The stone in human kidneys, normal medical complaint, is mostly calcium oxalate, which keeps on undergoing the precipitation reaction with the kidneys and creates a problem. Wow. So just by using criteria 2 and 3, you don't need criteria 1 actually. You can see that formate would not give you a PPT and oxalate would. Simple solubility data. 3 is the answer. You might say that we wish to explore option A also. You are welcome. Effervescence with CONCH2SO4. Now, if you add concentrated sulfuric acid, in this case, what do you get? Again, please note, option 1 is confusing. Normally, in qualitative analysis of anions, you have this, if it dilute HCl, certain anions produce effervescence. Effervescence is rapid evolution of bubbles, but please remember, in that case, the effervescence used to be that of CO2, and that reagent used to be dilute HCl. In this case, you don't have dilute HCl, you have CONCH2SO4, and the acids which you have, see all these four acids, none of them is going to give you effervescence. What is effervescence? Effervescence is rapid evolution of bubbles, gas bubbles. Formic acid is not a gas. Acetic acid, by no means it is gas, it's a liquid. You don't get effervescence of acetic acid, although by mistake in a number of textbooks, I have seen, or lab books rather, acetate ions are usually written in that format that if you add dilute HCl, you get effervescence. You don't get effervescence of acetic acid. Rather, you have smell of vinegar. That is how you identify that. So you don't have gas bubbles because they are not gases. They are heavy liquids. Benzoic acid is a goddamn liquid. Then, sorry, and oxalic acid is actually, you get solid crystals of oxalic acid. It's not even a liquid. It's a bakaida tosemtose acid. You don't have gas. You don't have effervescence of these substances. So what does this effervescence belong to? What is this actually? Actually, CONCH2SO4 is a dehydrating agent. So first of all, it is going to offer H+. The formic acid will change, sorry, sodium formate will give you formic acid. Sodium oxalate will give you oxalic acid. Try removing water from them. If you remove H2O, what would you be left with? CO. So formic acid would give you an effervescence of carbon monoxide. Oxalic acid is again going to give you an effervescence, and this time it is going to be a mixture of carbon monoxide and carbon dioxide. But the problem again remains, even if you download all this gyan, can you, by using first criteria, distinguish between 1 and 3? The answer is no. 1 and 3 you could have distinguished by a very easy criteria, number 3 also. So even if you know 1, you don't need 3. If you know 3, you don't know 1. I mean, you don't need 1. you have plenty of data, and by using any of this permutation combination, you should be able to address this beautiful question. This is relatively beautiful, not a very difficult one, but still better than most of the questions in this JEE 2017 main paper. That's it. And this brings us to question number 89. It says, a water sample has ppm level concentration of following anions. You have fluoride, sulfate and nitrate at 10, 100 and 50 ppm. The anion or anions that make the water sample unsuitable for drinking is R. Just let me, this is a question from 11th standard chapter environmental chemistry, flat mugging. You have to be aware of the data. Just a common sense idea, sulfate ions are often eaten as medicine in the form of Epsom salt. If you're trying to eat something in large quantities, obviously it would not be poisonous, at least it is going to be safe. As a matter of fact, for sulfate ions, if you have mugged up that chart from NCRD, the limit is around 500 ppm. Till that point, it's okay. It is no longer, not dangerous at all for humans. Nitrate, the limit is approximately around 50. Fluoride is more problematic. Why? Because sulfates and nitrates of most of the cations which are found in human blood are water soluble. Like magnesium ions, sulfate is water soluble. Calcium also, sulfate is water soluble if the concentration is less than 500 ppm. Otherwise, calcium sulfate will start precipitating in blood and it is going to choke the blood vessels. Nitrate is always soluble, so it does not create precipitation problems. Fluoride is poisonous by various means, one of the means being precipitation of calcium fluoride or magnesium fluoride. Plus there are other ways also by because of which fluoride actually is toxic. The toxicity level of fluoride is only 1 ppm. And in case you have 10, now 10 appears to be a lesser number than these, but fluoride actually is toxic. So the answer is only fluoride. Last and the least, question number 90. It says, which of the following on treatment with tertiary butoxide, sodium tertiary butoxide, followed by addition of bromine water, fails to decolorize the color of bromine? Now, bromine water would decolorize which species? The answer is alkenes, unsaturation. It is a characteristic test of unsaturation. Aromatic compounds not involved. In this case, if you look at all these substrates, none of these substrates is going to decolorize bromine water as they are. So it means that once they are treated with this tertiary butoxide ions, there would be some kind of a chemical reaction which should lead to formation of an alkene. Let's see what happens here. In this case, we have Br at benzylic position. If I make it react with tertiary butoxide ions, please note, tertiary butoxide is a powerful base, a bulky base, which typically favors elimination in comparison to substitution if there is a competition. In this case, stable carbocation, what would I get? Elimination? Yes. So this will be lost and this alkene is going to be the product. Will it decolorize bromine water? Yes. Is it an answer? No, because in our case, it should fail to decolorize bromine water. What about this? In this case also, oxygen's neighbor is a very, very stable carbocation. This will easily release Br plus. You have a carbocation, and carbocations most easily depart with their neighboring H plus. This alkene is going to be the major product, and alkene again would decolorize bromine water. So this is also not our answer. What about this one? In this case, Br, which is adjacent to C double bond O or C triple bond N, also is susceptible to substitution, no doubt. But again, tertiary butoxide is a bulky base. Would it lead to elimination? Unfortunately, more or less it would, although not as much as the previous ones, but still enough to give you decolorization of bromine water. So this is also not an answer. So what remains obviously is an answer. And in this case, if you see, this is very easy also because there is no beta hydrogen. There is no beta carbon only. So elimination is just not possible. The only possibility was substitution. So ultimately, thus this is going to be the product. And if this is going to be the product, it is not an alkene.